I'm Ollie Pam Branson and I'm a proud Ngunnawal and Noongar descendant. I grew up in Adelaide, South Australia. I am one of 10 children. 8 of us were taken by welfare. And I was very fortunate to be placed in a very loving and caring home with beautiful parents who today are still my parents. Unfortunately, some of my siblings experienced some shocking experiences, which I find very hard to heal from what they've been through, and very, very angry at what they were subjected to. It's very heartbreaking to know that your siblings were treated so badly compared to how lucky I was. That certainly has brought some anger out that, you know, we were children and we didn't have any choice in being in the system. So when I met my biological family, it was just after my 18th birthday, and on the 17th of March, just before midnight, my biological mother was murdered. Went to work because I was doing nursing, and you had 7 days on, 3 days off. Rostering shift work. So I came home from work in the evening, and my foster mum called me into the kitchen. She said, "Oh, you know, Pam, come here. I would like to have a talk to you. How was work today?" And all was good. And then she related to me about the conversation of the lady whose body was found in Victoria Racecourse. And she just said to me quite calmly and gently that was my biological mother. I didn't know how to react. I think this void just came over me, and my conversation was very limited. I didn't know what to say at all. Definitely turned my world upside down, and I lost all sense of commitment. Got on the bus and went down to where my biological mother was living, and it's a very profound moment in my life. And walking down the driveway, and there was two women coming out of the door of a flat with a baby in a stroller, and one of the ladies said, "Oh, you know, who are you, bub? What can I do for you?" And I said, "Oh, I'm Pam," and before I could say my sister just grabbed hold of me and started crying. She said, "Oh my God, you're my sister. I'm your sister Joy." It's an event that I'll never forget, and I will forever hold dearly. A little later on in the afternoon, my sister took off and rang other siblings, and we all met at another sister's house, Sharon's, and her husband Teddy, and the two little children, Selena and Daryl, and they all came together, and it was very overwhelming. You know, giving hugs to adults and that I've never met in my life. So there was a non-Indigenous man there, much older, and he came up and gave me the biggest hug and said, "Oh, so good to have you home, have you back. And your mum loved you." And then he went silent and he turned around and told me he was my father. After her death, there was organised for a viewing in Adelaide itself, where I had the opportunity to go down to. I had my best friend Michelle in tow, and my foster mum took me down. I'm so grateful and eternally grateful for that opportunity. It was quite overwhelming walking into the building with family that I didn't know anything about. Herbie, who pronounced that he was my father, came up and introduced me to the aunties, and which was a beautiful moment. Yeah, and then he walked me up to the coffin where a lot of the other family members were around, and he held my hand and he said, "Oh, come and meet your mum." And that was extremely overwhelming, but I kept myself together, and he had already had my hand and he put my hand on her hand, and at that moment I just went into freeze moment, couldn't touch her or talk to her like everyone was doing. So that was extremely hard. I feel so badly ripped off by the system. for not having to be taken by the system, and then secondly by her murder, because I didn't get the opportunity to meet her and ask her the questions that I never had the opportunity to ask, is why was I in the system? Wasn't I good enough? What did I do so wrong that you didn't want me? So those feelings had lived, have been a part of who I am. So I certainly had a lot of wonders about, you know, who was my mother, who was my father? Did I look like them? Did I have any brothers or sisters? And so all that, you know, fear, guilt, sadness, hatred that I had for my mother was really deep and intense. Never knowing who I was, my identity. And I grew up the really, I grew up a white way, in sense, and not knowing that I was different than my family. So the realisation that I was different than them kind of hit at the age of 8, when welfare popped around to do their regular welfare checks, and the welfare worker said, oh, your mum would like you to come back and live with her. And I was sitting there thinking, but my mum's sitting right here. So it wasn't until then that I realised that she was fairer than me, and there was a difference. I chose to go to work because of that numb sensation and not willing to deal with my emotions, being that strong person that I was raised to be. So I got to work, and the matron pulled me aside and said, oh, you know, Pam, we're sorry for what has the event has happened to you and your family, and we would like you to take bereavement leave. And I just chose no. No need. I don't need this. So they were very persistent, so we had taken bereavement leave. So I look back now and I'm grateful for that bereavement leave, even though there was a lot of mixed emotions that I was going through at that time. But, you know, when you're raised by a very strong woman, you just pull your socks up and get on with it. But life experiences definitely teaches you lessons in life. And I look back now and I think every experience that I've had has made me who I am today. And I never thought that I actually had trauma from this experience. I wish I had learnt earlier. More importantly, that my trauma has impacted on my children. You know, the circumstances about intergenerational trauma. And I wish I had some counselling earlier on so that didn't impact on my children. And then, you know, it rolls on to, you know, the next generation, to the grandchildren. It's not a very proud moment in my life to know that I, you know, my trauma has impacted on them, and it's hard to acknowledge that. It's hard to own that, and it's extremely hard to forgive those who have hurt you, but more importantly, forgive yourself. It's what drives me, is to share the story so there is a, you know, open conversation about educating the wider community that yes, this did happen, and it happened on a large scale that, you know, that we can never understand how many, you know, Indigenous people in our nation have been affected by the policies of the past governments. I still have reservations and a bit of anger towards the department. You know, I was made ward of the state at the age of 18. I wasn't signed off until, so 18 in March. I wasn't signed off until September. So that's 6 months after the murder of my mother. Not once did they reach out to me to see if I was coping, if I needed any counselling. You know, that would have given some difference. Got to move forward and encourage our family members who, or, you know, wider community who are experiencing stuff, that they're not alone. As much as you feel isolated from family and friends, it's definitely not an easy road. And I think accepting that you've got trauma is a step in the right direction. Acknowledging yourself and being proud of who you are, be strong, and it's not your fault. Seek help by talking to family or friends. Get medical advice from the doctor. Seek out someone professional in the mental health region to give you guidance and strength and strategies how to deal with this. It's not an easy road. And I think the really important message I want to speak to you is always about forgive yourself. It's a hard thing to forgive other people, but more importantly, to forgive yourself. To acknowledge my trauma has been quite challenging at the best of times, but with all that has happened in my life from my childhood up to now, which I'm now 59, and I haven't had the opportunity to or the need to put a picture of my mother up in my home. So today, through this experience and my major trauma of my hatred and anger for my mother, and forgiveness is a key component in all this. So today, thanks to this program and the opportunity to help me get through this process of my raw emotions, I'm now going to be proud enough to say, from today onwards, I am going to go home and put a photo up of my mother in my home. For myself, for my children, and for my grandchildren. I guess that I've accepted for the past events and move forward. And I know I'm never going to get the questions that I had for her. And that's okay. And it's about moving forward and enjoying my mother with my grandchildren and my children. End of.